So today we have all gathered here for panel discussion on social infrastructure, employment and human resource development in India. As per the economic survey published in 2008 for the year 2017, we have data about various schemes rolled out by the government in the last year, as well as successive governments which have rolled out various other schemes in the earlier years. As we know, for any developing economy, social infrastructure, health, education of the people are very important pillars to become a developed nation. And India, along with other developing nations, is spending more and more money in this in these domains. So for our today, for our discussion, we have with us Santhasa Sastri, Aditi Lutra, Anirudh Narayan, Aditi Mendiratta, and Navdeep Sen. So as I said, for any nation, the most important asset and wealth is its people. The country has to spend a considerable amount on the health and education of its people so that the development that it has attained is sustainable. As we know, over the years, India has achieved high growth rates over much more than the average world growth rates, and is well aspiring to become the fifth largest economy in the world, displacing the likes of Britain and France. While going on this endeavor, it is important that India spends its money for sustainable development, including for its people's health and education and the social infrastructure schemes. So let's start with Navdeep. Can you give us some insights of expenditure in the social sector?
Thank you, Pushkar, for the question. Okay, so I'll first elaborate a bit about social sector or social infrastructure. What does it include? So basically, it's divided into three major parts, that is the education, health and social protection of a country. As you mentioned here, earlier, that India is a developing country. From the start, India, being a developing country, has always didn't have enough money or fiscal to specifically provide expenditure on the education as well as health. So the margin of the GDP or the expenditure which we've been putting into education or health is roaming around between 6%. So near about 2015 and 16, it was around 5.8%, which is there's a marginal increase in it. That is around 6.6% in 2017 and 18. That is the percentage of GDP which is being put in specifically for the social sector, social infrastructure. And if you're focusing more on the state government as well, there's also an increase in the percentage of expenditure they've been putting in the social sector. Earlier it was around 6% in 2014 and 15. There has been a very marginal rise for around 6.9% in 2017 and 18. So the major crux is that India, being a developing country, don't have that much amount of fiscal to be spent on education or social sector. So they've been roaming around on these percentages only, between 5 to 7%. So which might be a worry in future, and that's it from the economic survey which we got.
So as we can see that there has been consistent rise in the spending in the social sector, for the social sector by the government of India. Successive governments have rolled out various schemes and allocated more and more money for social infrastructure and social sector, health and education. But yes, we need to do more because health and education are most important to sustain the development that we have till now. Yes, we have to also take care of the fiscal space and fiscal deficit, because we don't have that much resources, and we have to also look after our defense budget and other provisions for agriculture as well as railways, etc. But still, considering the 2018 budget rolled out by government in just a few days back, what are the allocations for the social sector for financial year 2018-19?
So there has been kept in mind, the healthcare is specifically kept in mind while presenting the budget. There is the major proposition made by the government is they've been presenting the world's largest government-funded healthcare protection plan. That would be named as the National Health Protection Scheme. It is around 2,000 crore will be spent on it, and selected 10 lakh families would be targeted for this insurance, which will be covering around 50 crores of beneficiaries. So that is a huge amount which will be covered under this. It is a huge initiative and is definitely focused more on health as far as the budget is concerned. And around 5 lakh families would be covered in it. The families would be specifically poor and vulnerable families. And secondary and tertiary hospitalization would be focused more upon it. And there's one another aspect known as Ayushman Bharat program, which will be focusing on opening health and wellness centers. Around 1200 crores would be spent on opening around 1.5 lakhs of health and wellness centers. So there has been a good focus on the health, specifically considering about the 2018 budget. India is focusing more now that on the human resources. They know that being a developing country, they have to focus on the health of the people. And yes, so they are there is a marginal rise and there is a good proposition made by the government.
So it seems even the government of India has understood the importance of health. And it has rolled out an ambitious project, also named as a Modi Care by many people. It will be covering more number of people than the Obama Care has ever covered. And it is a good trend to be seen in India for the first time that government is considering health as such an important issue. However, there are questions about the allocation of funds for the health sector. But then we'll come to that in the later part when we talk about health. So moving towards the education sector. Aditi, RDI Act was rolled out in 2009 with the aim to provide a free and compulsory education for all sections of the society so that no child misses out on primary education, which is very important for the growth of the nation. So what are your views about the RDI Act of 2009?
Yeah. So I'm sure we all must be knowing that our government is committed towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goal for Education, which talks about inclusion and education for all. So with this regard, we have the Right to Education Act 2009, which is now also called Right to Free and Compulsory Education Act, which talks about free and compulsory education to children between the age group 6 to 14 years. So what has happened is, over the period of time from 2009, the quantitative aspects of this act have improved. Namely, you know, the enrollment rates have gone up, the appointment of teachers have gone up, drinking water facilities have become better, the sanitation facilities have become better. However, the quality of education is still a problem. So there are two points that I would like to make in terms of the quality of education that we are talking about. Firstly, it was initially said in 2010 that whatever teachers that we have, till 2015, they should be qualifying the diploma in elementary education and doing bachelor's of elementary education. But it was found that in 2015, around 5 to 6 lakhs of private school teachers and 2.5 government, lakhs government school teachers were still just high school pass out. So then it was decided that we extend this deadline to 2019. So this is one of the reasons why I feel that the quality part is still lacking. The other reason is also that there was a scheme which said that nobody will be detained till class 8. So the students didn't have the motivation to study further, because even if you were studying or not studying, you were being promoted to the next class. So these were the two reasons I feel. So initially it was opposed that, you know, we shouldn't be really having this no detention policy. So coming this session, academic session, starting from April 2018, this the government will do away with this detention policy.
So definitely government is taking some good steps in the education sector as well. So Aditi pointed out that some changes are made to the act, RDI Act of 2009, but still there are what other steps are being taken to increase the learning outcomes? Some changes have been proposed in February to the Act.
Yeah.
So what are those changes?
Yeah. So as I mentioned in my previous answer, that now we have to focus more on the quality rather than the quantity. So now the learning outcomes are on the basis of class wise outcomes and subject wise outcomes. So these outcomes are basically the access points. So these are threshold levels which will say whether a person is actually attaining that learning level or not. And if that person is not attaining that level, then that will be communicated to his or her parents, and accordingly they will see that what changes have to be made. Now, the NCERT has finalized on 7 subjects of this learning outcomes. So English, Hindi, Urdu, Maths and all of these. And what they are doing is that, so for example, for class 1 student, he shouldn't just be able to recognize the alphabets, but should also understand basic instructions like shut the door or, you know, get the book to me. And for class 2, the person should be able to read or write basic sentences. So the level of the outcomes is increasing till class 8. And also what the HRD ministry thought was that we collaborate with a third party to evaluate the learning outcomes for both private and public sector schools.
So there are certain terms which are not very clear to the common people, like the SCR, PTR, and the GPR. So many people are not aware about these terms in the education sector. Can you elaborate more about these?
So SCR is basically student classroom ratio, now PTR is pupil teacher ratio, and GPI is the gender parity gap index. So what happens is that the RBI has laid down certain norms that, you know, ideal ratio should be this. So SCR is basically how many students should be there in a particular classroom. Now the ideal ratio for that is 30 people per classroom, and there are few states who have actually not been doing well on this, namely UP, Haryana, Bihar, West Bengal and Jharkhand. But there are states like Himachal Pradesh and Mizoram which are actually doing really well. Also, if you see from the overall country perspective, initially there were 43% of the schools who had more than 30 students per classroom, but that has come down to 25.7% in 2015 and 2016. Coming to pupil teacher ratio, that is basically number of students per teacher. So at the primary level, it should be 30:1, and for the upper primary level, it should be 35:1. Again, the states which I mentioned are not doing well in the student classroom ratio, are not doing well in the pupil teacher ratio also. And overall, but if we compare India globally with countries who have a similar social status, then we are fairly doing okay. So now, talking about the gender parity index, it is basically the inequality in access to education to the girl child. So we are doing fairly in terms of primary and secondary level education, but we are not doing well in higher education.
So as you see, there is some scope for improvement for all the states combined. Also, the center should allocate enough resources for the states to implement these kind of schemes where more participation from the girls, as well as the ratios are move towards the global standards. So to reduce the GPI, the gender parity index, Beti Bachao Beti Padhao scheme was launched by the government. So what is that scheme about?
Yeah. So this scheme was launched in 2015 to actually promote the security and survival and education of a girl child. So what was happening was that the child sex ratio was reducing to a great extent, and it had become critical to make people aware of what was actually happening. So, you know, the girls were being killed even before they were being born. So because of this, this was launched in 2015, and there was an investment of 100 crore rupees. And because of this, so there has been one very striking improvement. So for the first time in history, Haryana has a sex ratio of 950 girls to 1000 boys, which is something which has not happened before. And also 41 other districts have improved in this ratio. So this is something which is about Beti Bachao Beti Padhao.
So what we can see is Beti Bachao Beti Padhao has been implemented quite successfully, and it has reduced the GPI ratio actually. And also, apart from these schemes, the government has also moved towards greater autonomy to colleges and institutions, where there will be grades associated with autonomous colleges, and only those qualifying the threshold will be given autonomy. Also, the government has taken initiatives to set up centers of excellence. So some institutions who qualify for the global standards will be classified as centers of excellence, and these will be nurtured to become world-class institutions in the future. So this will definitely help in the scientific development of our nation, as well as technical education, which is important to the budding aspirants in the country. So Santha sir, the government is looking to codify the existing provisions of the Labour Reforms Act. So what is the process all about?
So why the codification was seemed important for government was because there are a lot of reforms, a lot of acts in this labour section, but there led to so many confusion, so many different authorities. So the government wanted to remove all the confusion and bring all of them under four categories. So those four were code on wages, code on safety and working conditions, code on industrial relations, and code on social security and welfare. So this codification, it was introduced in Lok Sabha on 10th of August last year, and it replaces the following four existing laws. The existing laws are Minimum Wages Act 1948, Payment of Wages Act 1936, Payment of Bonus Act 1965, and Equal Remuneration Act 1976. So it replaces this existing law. So now coming to what are the advantages of codification of these laws. First one is it removes the multiplicity of definitions and authorities that are involved in this law. Next is ease of compliance. So one particular rule applies for all, so easy to comply. Then ensure minimum wages to all and timely payment of wages to all employees irrespective of the sector. No matter what sector they belong, their wages will be paid timely. Then statutory national minimum wage was introduced. That is, no state government can fix a minimum wage which is lesser than what national level wage has been fixed. Next is proposed payment of wages through check or digital electronic mode. So directly the wages will come and fall into the bank account. So there is no question of middlemen involved here who may help their hold their pay for some reason. So next is minimum wages will vary from place to place depending on the type of work and also the geographical location where the work is based.
So definitely this looks like a step in the right direction, but we hear a lot of things about digital India or digitization. So how is technology being leveraged in these schemes?
Yes, so government, especially the current government, is focusing a lot on digitizing everything and on making everything digital. So even Modi government is not behind this. So they have introduced three technology initiatives in this law. That is, first one is Shram Suvidha Portal. Next one is UAN number and also National Career Service Portal. So I'll be talking a little bit more about that. So Shram Suvidha Portal is mainly a portal which is used for compliance, also maintaining the register of all the labor laws, rules, etc. UAN number is used to reduce the complexity of compliance and also to bring everyone under, similar to Aadhaar, bring all the laborers under one thing. Also, National Career Service Portal which was started, it is very useful for online registration purpose, posting of jobs and job seekers online, also to give career counseling, also to give vocational guidance and information on skill development and courses. So these are the whatever schemes have been made, those are not reaching the actual beneficiaries of the scheme. So making everything online, providing a portal where people can go search for jobs, apply by themselves, this is a very good scheme to do.
So technology will definitely simplify these processes and increase India's ranking on the ease of doing business by cutting the red tape and the bureaucracy. But there is a general gap in the labor workforce, not just in India but in the world. So right now talking about India, what is the status in India about the gender gap in the labor workforce participation?
So gender gap, as I said, is not only in India. We can see the similar trend all over the world. But India is not doing great. It is having a very big amount of gender gap, that is more than 50 percentage points. So this lower participation of women and in the economic activity, it affects the growth of the country. Because whatever part of laws have been made, if men are more in proportion, it will not reach maybe women or children of India. So it is very important to include women in the economic activities because they are known to be better decision makers. They know how to run household or business. So women are known to be better leaders. So gender gap will come because of many reasons. First, maybe because first of all, people are biased about women because they may not be able to perform as good as men. Next comes the question of class feelings. That is, women are not able to advance in their career after some particular stage. Also, family responsibilities come into picture, no support from family. All these things come into picture and makes gender parity more higher in parity.
So we see there are many reasons contributing to the gender gap that we see today in India as well as the world. But then the mindset of the people is changing rapidly. In the 21st century, we can see many women who are holding high positions, not just in India, but even in the global corporate world. In India, we have many examples like Nirmala Sitharaman or Smita Smriti Irani holding important portfolios in the government. And this does give a positive message to the people in general that women should be given higher roles and to encourage equal participation. So tell us something about the Manrega Act and what is its status in 2017. It is one of the most cherished act by the government to generate employment. And what is its status and how is it contributing to the society?
So Manrega Act was nothing but Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. So it was introduced in 2017, it was passed last year. So I'll be talking a little bit about that. The government spent around 48 crores for this project. It was the largest social security scheme in the world, which was guaranteeing 100 days of unskilled manual work to all household, rural household labor. So this was the obligatory for every state government, and they cannot deny 100 compulsory work days for any labor. Also, it gives the right to work to people. And the types of projects that are being undertaken under this are projects to build roads, canal, pond, wells, etc. Minimum wage material ratio has to be 60:40. The average wage per day per person in 2016-17 was 161, that was the minimum, and up to 500 in Kerala. 161 in Bihar to 500 in Kerala. So participation of women and backward classes was promoted using this. And also it was free from local money lenders and middlemen. So this was one of the major benefits of this particular act. Now talking more about this act, this ensures participation by women in economic activity. Minimum 33% of participation is ensured using this act. About 4.6 crore households were provided employment last year. In that, out of this 4.6 crore, 54% was produced by women. So this gives an indication that if women are given right opportunity, right set of guidance and funding by government, they can produce more than what the other section of the society can produce. So this was a major benefit.
So MGNREGA Act is positively contributing to the society, encouraging women to participate in the labor workforce. So the government has to be credited because it has carried the act which was initiated by previous governments, very generous gesture on their part. Also, talking about labor reforms, it is important that foreign companies invest in our country to generate employment as well as contribute towards the development of the areas. And labor reforms will go a long way in ensuring that companies and countries are encouraged to invest in India and Indian states, and contributing towards made in India and generating employment. So Aditi, coming back to the topic of women empowerment, we see that the participation of women in politics is not up to the marks, not only in India but in the world. In some countries we see active participation, but in others we don't. So what are the reasons according to you?
Sure, thank you for the question, Pushkar. There are various reasons for low participation of women in societies like ours, because we follow patriarchal norms and prejudices, and it had been precisely less than 15% in societies like India, Japan and other countries, whereas societies like Rwanda are doing quite well in the gender ratio when it comes to positions of women in the political activities or other economic activities. So some of the reasons I would like to state are domestic responsibilities, which are generally disposed onto women in India, making them restricted to the household chores. Also, we know that India is a growing country, so there are still some societies where the cultural attitudes are such which prevent women from taking up such decision-making roles. The third reason is lack of support of the family, and all these reasons also lead to lack of confidence in women. The other reason could be lack of financial help. So all these reasons contribute to low participation of women in India. But now the government is recognizing the fact that increasing this number is crucial for building the women's agencies and thus making India a progressive society. So you see there are articles namely 243D3 and 243D4 which reserve some seats for women in the houses. Also now there are some, the women participation has increased substantially at the local government levels, although it varies from state to state, but yeah, you can see some progression. So India is working towards it, but yes, the number is pretty low till now.
So definitely, are there any trends in India over time that the participation was low earlier and is now increasing? And are there any schemes rolled out by the government to empower women in the field?
Sure. So when we talk about trend, I would like to mention some numbers here. In the lower houses, there has been only 1 percentage point increase of the women's share between 2010 and 2017. In 2016, out of some 4,418 MLAs, only 9% were women. In 2017, in Lok Sabha, 11% the members were women, and in Rajya Sabha 11% of the members were women. So you see the participation is less than 15%, and even though it is increasing at a very slow pace. So yes, some inputs from the government are there in place for this particular situation, and it will increase in future. In the coming years, maybe slowly, and some years after that, maybe a bit more rapidly. Also, coming to the next question that you asked, the schemes to empower women. So yes, I am aware about the three schemes. One of them is Mahila Shakti Kendra. It is basically to address the issues of women at village levels, and over 300,000 student volunteers visit the most backward districts, which are 115 in number, to help the women in their issues. Also, some district level centers are being established at 640 different districts. The other scheme is Nayi Roshni, which is basically a leadership development program, and it is operational for benefiting the women belonging to minority communities. So
basically, a lot of efforts have been taken by the government to increase participation of women. But also a trend is that we need to change the mindsets before women enter the political workforce. And let's hope that in coming future we will see more women participation, as well as important portfolios being handed over to women and increasing their participation. So we now move towards another pillar of India's development, sustainable development, that is health. As you know, health of the people is the most important thing for any nation, and should be for any nation. There are various healthcare providers, and in India now foreign players have been encouraged to enter. So Anirudh, what are the healthcare providers in India?
Since you mentioned the word sustainable, I'll say that the SDG, that is Sustainable Development Goals, have been set by WHO, and India is highly committed to SDG. So ensuring healthy lives and promoting the well-being of all the ages is a part of sustainable development. And the main healthcare providers in India are majorly four, that's government, private, pharmacies and others.
So what is the breakdown of the expenditure of the sector?
So the breakdown has been quite different for all these providers. We expect that the government would be providing more, but what we find is that private sector has been providing more with the percentage of about 31.3%, while the government is still at 23.1%, and the pharmacies surprisingly have 28.9%, and the others have 16.7%. So in the private sector, I'll say that there are two main players, that's Apollo Hospitals, which has Apollo Mini Health Insurance, and Max Health Life Insurance. So these are the main players in the private healthcare.
Sure. So there are many abstract concepts in the health sector, mainly DALY and LEP. So can you give us what these concepts mean and what is their status in India?
Yes. So both these terms, DALY and LEP, are quite related to each other. Both are inversely proportional to each other. An improvement in one causes decrease in the other. So coming to the concept of DALY is actually the disability adjusted life years. So it is the number of years that a person loses that has been lost because of a certain kind of disability or death. And since we are talking on a national level, we'll say that it is the number of years lost across the country because of a disability or a death. So one DALY is equal to 1 year. And for example, if a person lives for about 20 years and average lifespan is about 70 years, so actually he's lost 50 years. So it's about 50 years lost. And coming to the figures that have been noted in the economic survey, DALY has shown great improvements. It has dropped from 36% from 1990 to 2016. That's a great achievement for India. And most of this achievement has come from a drop in the deaths by communicable disease. The communicable disease have dropped from 61% in 1990 to now about 33%. But there is a different view. Since communicable diseases have gone down, but the non-communicable diseases have gone up, and the rates are about 30% to 55%. And now the government is asking the state governments to increase their health budget by about 8%. That's an initiative for reducing this problem that has arisen. And then coming to the other abstract concept, that's LEB, which is life expectancy at birth. India is fairly really good in this LEB factor. About 10 years have increased, the life expectancy of 10 years has increased from the year 1990. So now a person lives 10 years more. That's the average lifespan. And surprisingly, despite improvements in overall LEB throughout the India, there have been differences throughout the states. So in Uttar Pradesh, you see that the life expectancy is about 64.5 years, while in Kerala it's about 75.2 years. So there needs to be a particular policy that brings a standardization in this, so that the life expectancy can be averaged and can be improved throughout the India.
So DLY going down and LEB rising up shows that India is on the right path of development. But then there are some contrasting figures which say that states should increase their health budget in order to match the global or the national standards. And definitely the government will be taking some steps in this direction to increase the health expenditure as well as the health facilities available. So Navdeep, in the initial phase mentioned about the 2018 budget allocation for health sector. So is there anything that you would like to add or elaborate on this aspect?
Yes, India has done a great job. The government has done a great job in the budget. It's provided it's focused on the health schemes for India. So there is Ayushman Bharat program, as Navdeep mentioned, as for about 1200 crore for 1.5 lakh health and wellness centers. While the other program, that's National Health Protection Scheme, is there. So I'd like to say something about the National Protection Scheme. That is the second flagship program in the budget, and it covers about 10 crore people throughout India, 10 crore families throughout India, and taking an average of about 5 people per family, there's about 50 crore people that will be covered in this scheme, and the 10 crore families would be having the coverage of about 5 lakh rupees per year for the secondary and the tertiary care hospitalization. And this will be the world's largest government-funded healthcare program. So adequate funds will be provided for smooth implementation of this program throughout.
So even after the budget, we can see that there are many discrepancies. The budget allocation is just 2,000 crores. So many experts are saying that they will require at least 10,000 or 12,000 crores. But then there are some assumptions that not the 50 crore people will avail of the facility, and the final will not be used by everyone. So maybe there is some fiscal space where the government can accommodate the demands of the people. But then it needs to see how well it is implemented in India for this financial year. And states have to increase their health projects. So Aditi, now we're talking about expenditure. Let's come to the schemes and initiatives taken by the government for women and children empowerment in India. So what are the schemes? Can you tell us something about?
Yes, I am aware of four schemes that are there for women and children in India. The first is Integrated Child Development Services. As the name says, it is for the children and it aims at the holistic development of children up to 6 years of age, and it also takes care of the nutritional requirements of pregnant women and lactating mothers. Also recently, four child-centric schemes, namely Anganwadi Services, Schemes for Adolescent Girls, National Krishi Scheme, and Child Protection Services. These are also approved by the government. Moving on, the second scheme is Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. So you all must be aware about the maternity benefit program. It has been renamed as Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. It is a centrally sponsored scheme and it provides partial compensation to pregnant women for the wage losses during pregnancy. The amount is 6,000 per woman per pregnancy. And the third scheme is National Nutrition Mission. It has been recently commenced and it aims for the reduction of anemia, low weight birth and undernutrition among children. The last scheme is Pradhan Mantri Ujjwal Yojana. It provides LPG connections to 5 crore women belonging to the BPL families over a span of 3 years, and it commenced in 2016-17. Since its inception, already 3.3 crore women have facilitated through this scheme.
So we see many schemes are then implemented by the government, and in a developing nation it is important that government rules up such schemes, because people falling under below poverty lines levels able to sustain on themselves. So they need state and government support, and this is a good initiative that the government is looking positively in this direction. So now coming towards another most glorified talk about mission of the government, the Swachh Bharat mission, which was launched in 2014. So what is its status and what are some statistics that you would like to share?
Thank you, Pushkar, for your question. So as you already spoke, that it is one of the most glorified policies given by the government, along with demonetization. So there have been two aspects related to Swachh Bharat. One is, it was launched on the 2nd October in 2014, on Gandhi Jayanti. And so the Prime Minister made an appeal to the whole country that we need to unite towards a cause, and we need to, basic public etiquette should be followed, and littering on the roads and public places should be avoided. But there is also an aspect of what the government has been doing behind from their part. So there have been a lot of stats, and there have been surveys conducted whether Swachh Bharat is actually working or whether it is benefiting or not. So the results are clearly positive. We've been seeing changes that are very positive, and the implementation has also been good. So Swachh Bharat has not only been focusing on the cleanliness of the country, but it is also focusing on the education, spreading education regarding to the health related and cleanliness, how the cleanliness of water which you will be drinking is responsible for your health, how your personal sanitation as well as education related to this is important to you. So I'll be giving some numbers. The coverage which was the earlier governments or earlier we had the rural coverage for the health and sanitation plans were around 39%, only 39% in 2014, which grew around to 76% in 2018, which is a huge number. And this has been a result of Swachh Bharat initiative as well. Promoting such initiative led to this huge coverage, specifically on the rural side of India. And the other aspect, which is education related to the health and cleanliness and personal sanitation, that has also shown results a lot. Earlier, people who were actually accessing toilets or had access to toilets, they were still not using it, and open defecation was still there. But now, due to spread of education, more than 90% of the people who have access to the toilets do use the toilet. So there has been a great change, especially in the mentality of people. So yes, as well as the numbers also support that. So the Swachh Bharat is yes, doing pretty well.
So as rightly pointed out, one of the main issue facing the rural areas is open defecation free areas. People are not using toilets when they are set up. So are there any health indicators for differentiating ODF and non-ODF areas in the rural areas?
So as I mentioned, open defecation is when you are not using toilet but littering in open. So there has been a tremendous increase in the numbers in where open defecation free areas or villages or districts are concerned. I'll go through some numbers. 296 districts have been declared open defecation free, which is a good number. And around 300,000 villages have been declared open defecation free. I'll be referring it as ODF. So what changes it has brought in the health of general Indian is, as a survey conducted by UNICEF, around 50,000 per family is spent on healthcare if open ODA families are not there, or sanitation is not proper. So that counts around 6% of the GDP. If the sanitation is not proper, so 6% of GDP is going in vain. So ODF has brought a lot of help in this. A survey was conducted by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. They surveyed around 4,000 households, out of which 2,000 were ODF households, whereas 2,000 were non-ODF households. And the results clearly show that ODF households were far better in the various parameters they were judging on it. The parameters were, they checked upon the prevalence of diarrhea in the families, which showed a great number. In the ODF families, it was around 15.1%, whereas in non-ODF families, it was around 22.1%, which is a great difference. And similarly, the or the kids who are malnutrition or related to having diseases related to that. That is also the numbers also show that ODA families are doing better in that case. The health of women, as Aditi has been focusing on women in parliament and the role of women in the coming years. The health of average women, the BMI of a woman in ODA families is far better than in non-ODA families. The education is better in ODA families. People are educated in ODA families, which clearly shows that education, if spread well, will lead to health and better health and sanitation for the country.
So yes, the Swachh Bharat Mission, also known as the Cleanliness Drive, which was a very ambitious project and well conceivable, you can say, after looking at the stats. So yes, the government has taken some right steps to eradicate sanitation problems in rural as well as urban areas. And there have been certain cases where health indicators clearly show and there is much profit, there are many profits generating from these schemes. So now we come to the conclusion of this panel discussion. I would like to thank you all for your inputs. We had a very fruitful discussion over here about various topics. And coming back to concluding about our entire topic as a whole, an overview. So we talked about education, health, we talked about labor reforms, as well as political empowerment of women, and the Swachh Bharat Mission. So overall, we see that in the year 2017, there has been many positive steps taken by the government, which should be reinforced with such steps to be taken in the coming years. Also, for India to compete with China and other developed nations, we need to take care that we spend very judiciously in the social infrastructure, health and education, as we have to maintain the demography, and not just maintaining the demography, but we also have to maintain the advantage that the demography is providing us, and this can only be achieved by health and education of our people. So, thank you.
Thank you.